I would want to take this opportunity just to give a recap. Basically, what I'll do, I will mention each issue that was discussed and how far we've gone with the implementation and what remains to be done, so that at least as we prepare for, you know, a major conference sometime next year, we can monitor our progress with regard to what we had agreed on in our last conference. So in the next 10, 15 minutes, I want to quickly go through the highlights of Easter Investment Conference. You'll recall that the theme for that conference was development and innovation. That theme was crafted in order to see how we could use the diaspora for the national development. And basically, we were discussing opportunities that are available for the diaspora. The attendance was over 1,300. And you'd recall that the venue where we were, it was busy. We had over 1,300 participants and over 60 exhibitors. We had about 62 exhibitors that were partnering with us. And you will also remember that we had members of the diplomatic corps. It was combined together with our ambassadors and high commissioners conference, the biennial ambassadors and high commissioners conference. And we also had a session whereby members of the diplomatic corps based in Kenya here in Nairobi were there. They presented. Now, during that conference, we had an interactive session with His Excellency the President and His Excellency the Deputy President. We had an interactive session, and you engaged both the President and his deputy. A number of issues came up, which you raised with the President. And I do recall even the Deputy President giving some deadlines of 2 weeks for certain things that were to be done. I don't know whether the gentleman who was promised electricity within 2 weeks is here to confirm that following instructions from His Excellency the Deputy President, he was able to be connected with the power within 2 weeks. I think that was a critical thing that raised during the interactive session. There was also a lady from Germany, those of you who were there, and she had serious consular matters to deal with, and I would want to report that the matters were dealt with and the issue was resolved. In addition, we had government policies. We had the Ministry of Labor, the PS was there, gave a presentation on labor migration. We had things to do with the passports and all those things they were given. And we had our private sector also, participating in the official opening. You remember the CEOs of KCB, the CEOs of Cooperative Bank, the CEOs of Family Bank. You know, the major CEOs that sponsored that program were there. Now, having said that, let me now look at the status of recommendations that came up. During that Easter Investment Conference, the issue of investment fora and expos for the diaspora came up. And I want to report that so far we've held very, very three successful investment fora. We had one in Dallas, Texas, which was done, we took a number of investors who met the diaspora there. That was under the King's Pride. We had another one that took place in South Africa recently. And then there was also one that was held in Australia. And basically, this underscores the kind of collaboration that we have with the private sector. And we have agreed amongst ourselves that we'll come out with a calendar of activities which we shall be sharing with you, the diaspora, so that you are able to know that where you are, this is the event that is going to take place and in such and such a place. So that is being done. Then the issue of investment in the counties. Those of you who were here during the official opening, you saw the deputy governor of Kiambu. I would say that we've had a lot of interactions. The Minister of Foreign Affairs has been also holding town hall meetings with the counties, whereby they bring county executives and then they discuss with them the opportunities so that we are able to pass over this to the diaspora. We have held a number of those sensitization fora with the counties. Then another issue that came up also was the issue of diaspora conferences. We had agreed that we need to have at least once a year. So we had one in April. The next one will be held next year also, taking into account, using the private sector, using the members of the diaspora. And I believe that the next one, which we are going to hold, will be done within the ambit of the NADICOC, which we are talking about. I believe by then, hopefully, we would have finalized arrangements to establish NADICOC. And then we are also saying that we want to bring our honorary consuls. I know members of the diaspora, especially from the US, we have been talking about our consulates, our honorary consuls. So this time we want to bring the consuls with us in the next conference. It's unfortunate that last time they were not there, but this time we want to bring them on board. Now we also talked about regular diaspora magazine, and I want to report that the first issue should be coming out early next year. This is meant, we want to go electronic. We'll do a digital sort of magazine. We are working on it, and I believe that early next year, this will be done. Of course, it will be printed both in electronic and print. Appointment of honorary consuls is also something that you, the diaspora, raised, especially with the session with His Excellency, the President. I know that some of you may not be getting the right consular services based on, where you are and, So at the moment, we have 28 existing honorary consuls and spread all over. I mean, that's excluding our missions, but honorary consuls. And I want to report to you here that my office is considering 26 others. And I believe out of these 26, when you meet in the next conference, would be reporting how many of them we would have cleared and how many of them would have been in place. There are some regions that we are not well represented. I know diaspora from West Africa, we only have one mission there, and we are thinking of having honorary consuls in some of those countries. The same also happens with the US. It is so expansive, and we have so many diasporas in different places. So your representation was received, and we are considering establishing honorary consuls in those cities that we had discussed before. So basically, of course, all this is to improve consular services, and we have an expanded reach to the diaspora. We also talked about establishing a comprehensive database of diaspora skills. This is in progress. And following this, of course, we started a web portal and our Kenya missions abroad have been detailed to follow on this. But what I would like to say here is that there's a bit of low response in terms of you people in the diaspora, giving us your skills. We are engaging a firm called IBM to help us with, digitizing the profile, the skills profiles of members of the diaspora. But you see, before we reach there, we would really want you people to come up. We had a web portal, we have our missions, we have been telling them, but the response has been not so good. I think my appeal to you is that, let us take this up. There are a lot of opportunities that we want you to benefit from. We can only do this if you have the proper diaspora skills profile. Currently, we've done it. We are halfway through, but we are appealing that we do more in terms of registering. Another matter that came up was remittance transaction costs. I think at the time we had the conference, we must have talked about Kenya hosting the African Air Remittance. And of course, those of you who listened to the official speech that was read by the ambassador, the speech of our cabinet secretary, she told us that AI is now in operation. We are privileged this afternoon that the interim executive director is here, and I believe he will be able to tell us more. What is it that they have done? What is it that they are trying to do? And we, the diaspora, will be able to know, to be briefed exactly what's happening on the issue of the transaction costs of your remittances. Now, NADICOC, I think this will be presented tomorrow, but what I would want probably to emphasize is that already there is a concept note and this will be unveiled. And the reason for unveiling it is for you people to give your input, because this is a council, the diaspora council, which basically your ideas in terms of how it should be run needs to be taken on board. So I won't talk much about that. Another very, very important matter that came up was the diaspora voting. And of course, as you are aware, there is the Supreme Court ruling that was delivered the other day. And of course, a lot of effort has been done in terms of, you know, the diaspora to participate in the to progressively participate in the national elections and referenda. And we are privileged that the CEO of IEBC will be here shortly, and I would want him to talk to you about that. He'll be able to tell you more. Bilateral labor agreements, particularly for our brothers and sisters from the Middle East, this was something that is, you know, it's critical to you. You were very much passionate about it. I would wish to report that we have made some breakthrough. We were able to have signed agreement with Saudi Arabia, and early in the year, the bilateral labor agreement will be able to be signed. We are also pursuing another one with the United Arab Emirates, and I believe before the end, before the end of the next financial year, that is June 2016, we'll be able to have confirmed and have signed labor agreements with those two countries, as we mentioned. Now, marketing Kenyan second generation diaspora tourism. We are thinking of, the issue here was, how do we promote the second or third generation Kenyans who are outside there so that they know more about their country? I want to report that already we have taken up this program, and we are working in very close collaboration with KTB. And we hope that we will be able to do this. Now, as was also mentioned during the official opening, the issue of one diaspora, one tourism drive. If all of us can give an undertaking that in 2015, you will invite a friend to Kenya, can we imagine the kind of impact it will have on our tourism? Just a friend. If we in the diaspora, we can give an undertaking that we have next year, at least we invite a friend to come to Kenya, the one tourism, one diaspora drive, I think we'll be doing quite a lot in terms of promoting our tourism. So we are doing that. Now, partnership with diaspora in ICT, training, innovation, knowledge exchange, and skills transfer. The Kenya Diaspora Fellowship Program, which through the initiation of one of your colleagues, Professor Kefa Otiso and Dr. Emmanuel Mutisia, is also something that the office has taken up, and we are, it's a mentorship program which we are looking into. I believe when Dr. Emmanuel Mutisia comes here, he'll be able to say something about it. I had a presentation on YouTube which I got from Professor Tiso. My worry is these things are not clear. I can see the screens are not very clear. But we should be able to do this. But maybe just to inform that it is something that has been taken over, we want to have a mentorship to use our scholars who are raised abroad on how they can bring back to this country the kind of skills they have gained for the benefit of all of us. I think I want to stop there. I've just over-summarized. Those were the main broad areas that we agreed on. And probably if there is somebody with any burning question with regard to that, then probably could raise it up. Otherwise, maybe we could call upon the next panel to come up, and we give the second, the next presentation. Thank you very much for listening to me. Any question? Did I cover what we talked about? Anything that I've left out? Those of us who are there, this is like matters arising from the previous minutes. Okay, I think silence means that we have comprehensively covered, and thank you so much. Let me now call upon the next panel. We will have two MCs. Dr. Mutisia will be an MC here, and Mr. Peter Wairega, if they could come and guide us through the next session. Doctor, you want to come on top? Thank you so much.
Yes, good afternoon. I know it's very difficult to talk after lunch, and especially when an hotel like Safari Park Hotel gives us such a generous package of big plates full of, I don't know what you ate, but I believe that you had some chapatis. So please, as we move forward, I know you're tired, but we only have a few hours before the end of this session and before you break out for your Christmas. So let us engage ourselves to make this session an exciting session. Now, as part of the program, I would like to take this opportunity to invite the next session presenters, and we are going to start with the perspectives on diaspora remittances. Just a quick small change in the program because of some unavoidable circumstances. So right now, I would like to welcome on stage the panel speakers. The first one is Mr. Amadou Cisse, the Interim Executive Director of the African Institute of Remittances. The second one is Mr. Kingsley Aikins. He's not in. He's coming? Okay, please. Then we have our Mexican representative. Yes, Mr. Kingsley, we're waiting for you. Mexican representative, is he in with us? And then finally, we have Mr. Peter Zalu from the Central Bank of Kenya. So this team here is going to talk about opportunities for partnership with the Kenya diaspora. And in order of the program, I'm going to start with Mr. Cisse, the executive director, please.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, MC. I was introduced by MC. My name is Amadou Cisse. I'm the Interim Executive Director of the African Institute for Remittances. As you all know, the African Institute for Remittances is an African Union offices. It is a specialized technical office hosted by the government of Kenya here in Nairobi. We have started our work here in Nairobi in October, and since we have already organized some events, including one hosting in the premises of our office, but also a networking forum that we've just concluded in Naivasha here with all the stakeholders, including the central banks, including the diaspora, including the private sector, and all the people that we have to work with. Today, maybe I will not just talk about the opportunities that we have, but I will also try to just inform you about the institute, inform you more about the institute, what are our objectives and what we are really doing. Before that, let's talk about the rationale of this institute. As you all know, the remittances to flows to Africa are already all today one of the most important capital flow to Africa. Despite the crisis in 2008 and 2009, the remittance to Africa is still high, consistent, and it benefits to a lot of our population here in Africa. Now, why is it important? We are going to talk about two things. First, it is the statistics. We are going to show the statistics, why it is important to talk about remittances, why it is important to have this institute. And the second thing is that we are going to talk about the potential. In terms of statistics, as I've just said, it's unfortunately still not clear here, you will see that the remittances here in Kenya from 2004 to 2015, based on the records of the central banks of Kenya, has consistently, the remittances have consistently increased in Kenya. And as of this year, in September, the volume of remittance, it was recorded to 1.15 billion. Compared to what we had in last year in September, for the first 9 months, we had 1.06 billion. This trend is not an isolated trend. It is something that you can see at any time. At any time, remittances are growing. But the issue there is, what does it cost to our migrant to send those money here in Kenya, but it is also, what does it cost to our migrant to send money in all over the Africa? One finding of our studies is that it's most costly to send money in Africa, or even within Africa, than any other part of the world. Actually, sending money to Africa costs around 12% of the amount that we send. While we know that in some part of the world, maybe when we talk about the Emirates Arab, or even the Middle East in general, the cost is only 3%. The question that we ask ourselves is, why is it so expensive to send money in Africa? Why is it so expensive to send money to Africa? Why is it so expensive to send money within Africa? This is one of our main objectives, to cut the cost of sending money to Africa. We have so many reasons there. It could be the payment system. It could be something like so many other things. But whatever are the reasons, we have to reduce the cost of sending money to Africa, because at the end of the day, it is the money of our migrants that should come to Africa that they still get it there. Now, based on that, we have our mandate to break the cost of sending money to Africa. But beyond that, we have the mandate to know the amount that we are talking about. Because if we were talking about $1,000, we would not be here to talk about remittances. We are talking about billions of dollars. We are talking about something like $64 billion sent to Africa. We are talking about financial flows that are higher than foreign direct investment. We are talking about financial flows that are higher than ODA, Official Development Assistance. So there is a potential to do something with that amount. We know that it is private money, but even when we talk about foreign direct investment, it is private money. The only thing that we have to do is how to help our diaspora to invest, how to help our government, our countries, to benefit more from that, those amounts that are sent to Africa. It means that we have to improve our statistical systems to capture those amounts, but also we have to design suitable strategies to leverage the remittance sent to Africa. In a nutshell, those are the three objectives that we have: cut down the cost of sending money to and within Africa, improve the measurement, and lastly, to maximize the impact of the remittances. How to do that? You may find yourself as diaspora in that work. First of all, we have what we call the governance structure of our institute. In our governance structure, we have three elements. One is the governing board. The second one is the consultative, the consultative forum. And in the consultative forum, we have representatives from the diaspora community. And the last one, it is the secretariat, which is the institute itself. And the consultative forum is like a forum like this one, but also more formal, where we'll get feedback from all the stakeholders, including the diaspora. It is in the consultative forum that the diaspora is going to tell us, you are talking about remittances, you are talking about leveraging, this is what we think, and this is how we should do that. And you need to organize yourself to nominate some representatives to that forum. On top of that, we have the governing body. The second thing where the diaspora should also help the institute to achieve its mandate is to regularly consult what we call our database, the Saint Mary Africa. Because for us to cut down the cost of sending money to Africa, we have to make the remittance market more transparent. Most of you who send money to Africa know that when you get to the remittance service provider, you want to send $100 or $200 or $500, it's most of the time difficult for you to know in advance how much money is going to be given to your recipient, because there are some hidden costs there. There are some hidden costs, including the exchange rate that is going to be applied. And the Send Money Africa is going to tell you, if you want to send money from this country, UK, USA, or wherever you are in the world, if you want to send money from this country to Kenya or to any other African countries, this is how much it is going to cost you. And we will tell you through that database which remittance service provider gives you the lowest cost. And this Send Money Africa is already available online. It's been working for more than 2 years. It was hosted by the World Bank, and now it is hosted by the Institute itself. And we have released the latest data on the cost of sending money to Africa in September 2015. For you now, to have a full usage of this tool, to be aware of how much it's going to cost you and to always choose the cheapest. So the others will follow and cut down their cost. This is one way to do that, though that there are some initiatives at the international level like the G8 and so, but this is, we think, the most effective way to show to those who charge you more than they should to bring them, cut their costs. Now in terms of perspectives, we are working with diaspora, but also we are working here in Kenya and all over in Africa with the financial sector, including the central banks, to change first the legislation, but also to be more innovative and to propose different financial products. You will find that it is easy, for example, for some Kenyans to send money through M-Pesa and so. This happened, this is possible for you because Kenya was well innovative enough. This is not the case for all African countries. We want to make sure that all African countries benefit from the experience of Kenya, but also even Kenya benefits from the experience of other countries. The other thing is that when it comes to financial products, generally we are thinking about the diaspora bonds, but first it's not only the diaspora bonds, which is a development product, but we are looking at other individual financial products that you, diaspora, can use, can a financial product can profit to you, diaspora. In all these things, we need your ideas. We are going to propose in the next few months, maybe next year, some financial products, but we would like to have also your insight on all these things. These are some words that I would like to, on the things that I would like to share with you. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Cisse, for that exciting presentation. I know most of us do not know what this African Institute of Remittances stands for. We don't know what it's going to do, and we're happy that at least you've informed us that you're going to cut our cost of sending money home from, was it 12%, to something that is more acceptable, so that we can use that money to develop our country. I would like to open for one or two questions to Mr. Cisse. Anyone with a question that needs sort of his reaction? I think we have one gentleman over there.
All the ladies and gentlemen, all protocols observed, I salute you all. However, I would like Director Mr. Cisse to kindly look into this. What are we going to do, especially the Kenyans in the Middle East, to ensure that they are going to enjoy through your institution as much as you talk of, at least on the remittance coming here? The way we are supposed to send money back home, it should be a bit cheap. We are having a very hard task on it, and especially right now, even the money is not being sent from Qatar specifically to this country. There is a very serious problem until we have to use M-Pesa. What are we going to do? What is your institution doing? The person speaking is Reverend Habakkuk Wamduda, the founder chairman of Kenya Qatar Diaspora SACCO. Thank you all.
Thank you very much, Reverend. The next question should go to Dr. Shem Ochiodo. And then I'll take one more and then give the microphone back to Mr. Cisse.
Thank you very much, Emmanuel. I'm chairman of the Kenya Diaspora Alliance, an umbrella body of diaspora associations. I'm delighted to hear that AIR is considering getting diaspora to nominate their representatives. I think that's the way it should go. But very often we are told that private sector and governments, to a large extent, are interested in remittances, but not so much interested in the people who bring the remittances. Can you give us assurance that AIR will also look into ways, how do we grow this remittance that they bring home, rather than just focusing on the remittances, but not the people who bring the remittances? That's the question I would like to ask. But the last one is, how do you intend to reach out to the diaspora groupings? Do you have a strategy for that? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ochiodho. I'm going to take one last question, if there's any, and then we close the question and answer questions, session, then give the microphone back to Mr. Cisse. One last question over there, please.
Thank you. My question will also go to Director, Dr. Cisse. My name is Wilfred Odoyo from South Korea, working on IT. We send money, yes, and we are being charged. As you say, this cost will reduce. It depends in each and every country. That is understandable. But when I send money, I want to have a choice whether we can be given Kenya shillings or US dollar. Because as you say, there are so many charges that I think are already taken care of by me sending the money. I know this depends on each and every bank, but the banks have used, or the agencies that take off the money don't require you to ask for US dollars. So can we have that as an option? And how are you going to standardize that amongst all the agents? Thank you.
Thank you very much for that question. Mr. Cisse, please.
Thank you so much, and thank you for your interest. Thank you for the very interesting questions. First of all, with regard to the Middle East, maybe we should discuss it further, but we know that it is very cheap and very easy for all of our diaspora living in Egypt and all the Northern Africa to send money from the Middle East to Africa. And to tell you that it is actually the cheapest corridor, sending money from Dubai and all the Qatar and everything to the Middle East, to Africa. And the cost is around 3%. Now the issue that you have raised, the corridor between the Middle East and Kenya, this we should know, we should really look at it and then check really what is happening there. But our figures, our findings are very clear, so that we are really interested into the corridor between the Middle East and the Northern Africa. We should try to reach out with you and then find out what is going on there. The second thing is now, what are we doing with the diaspora? So, you know, at the African Union, we have a unit which is really dealing with the diaspora, a whole unit which is even a directorate, like the directorate that we have here, dealing with the diaspora. They have their own mapping of all the diaspora in the main cities in the world, like you have in UK, in US, and so and so. The institute will build on what they have already, because it is their job to know who is sending, where the diaspora people are. But the issue is there is that when they deal with the diaspora, they are not just looking at really the money that they send to Africa, but they are looking at so many issues, including the voting rights, for example, that was raised here.
those are issues that are also discussed at the level of the African Union. So, and they have their own methodology to work with the diaspora, and we'll build on that. And they are the ones who are really looking at the living conditions and all the other aspects with diaspora. It's not all, it's not really us doing that. When we deal with diaspora, it is mainly in the issue of remittances, to help them to send money in better conditions, to make sending money to Africa cheaper, safer, and faster. Those are the issues that we consider when we discuss with the diaspora. But I'm sure, and I assure you that at the AU level, we have so many people working on the other aspects of those who send money. Now, in terms of now the options of the currency in which you want the people who receive money to get their money, this is about legislation. Maybe Mr. Zali, who is Peter, who is on my left, could elaborate more. Maybe after his presentation, he could also answer this question. But I know that in terms of legislation, there are a lot of countries who do not really allow people to get money in their in foreign currency. They will get their money, whatever it is, in the local currency. This is an issue of legislation for many reasons that we can develop is here, but this is not the case. This cannot be addressed as specific issue of by the institute. Frankly speaking, what we are interested in is that this money that you send to Africa is cheaper. Now, in terms of legislation of the option to choose which money and so, this is a job of the central bank. I think it's better to leave their job too. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Cisse. I believe that the three questions have been answered satisfactorily. Mr. Cisse is not going anywhere. He's going to be here until the end of today. So if you have more questions, get a hold of him, and I'm sure that he'll be able to respond to your questions. But also note that the institute is located in Kenya, and I believe that diaspora has a big role to play, even in the kind of names of people who should be incorporated into the institute. And given it's in Kenya, most of my fellow diasporians could perhaps consider that possibility. A round of applause to Mr. Cisse. Thank you very much. Before we go to the next speaker, I would like to call upon two more panelists, Sagini Onyanja Simbapei, to come forward, and also Walter Ruingu, China Africa Merchants Advisors, to also come forward to join the panel of discussants. Now I would like to take this opportunity to invite Mr. Kingsley Aikins to give us his perspectives. Thank you very much. Thank
you. Good afternoon, everybody. Sorry, let's try that again. Good afternoon, everybody. I've got the graveyard shift around between 2 and 3 o'clock when that pasta begins to settle in and your eyes begin to droop, the heat comes in and the wind dies down, and they gave it to me. And I came all this way to a country that I've never visited before. I'm fascinated to be here because when I was a kid, my hero was Kip Keino, and you now know how old I am, but he was a phenomenon. I just loved him. And you know, next year, the Kenyan flag is going to be flying a lot in Rio because your athletes are going to do your country enormously proud, and Kenya will be up there in lights globally, and we'll all admire what you do in that area. And I believe that sometime soon, a Kenyan runner is going to run the marathon in less than 2 hours. And that's going to be extraordinary. Because we all remember Roger Bannister, who ran the first sub-4-minute mile in 1951. But nobody remembers who ran the second sub-4-minute mile. And within 1 year of him winning that race, 37 people ran sub-4-minute miles. But everybody remembers Roger Bannister. So I want to say thank you to the organizers, to the dignitaries who are here, to our ambassador, to Jane Ann here, for facilitating this visit. I'm absolutely delighted to be here. Congratulations on putting together what Tim this morning said was an extremely effective policy, your communication strategy. I believe that there is in front of you in Kenya a really glittering prize, that you can become one of the top 10, and there are 200 countries in the world plus, you can become one of the top 10 diaspora engagement countries in the world. But that will need focus, it will need attention, it will need resources. And the harsh reality is if you do nothing in this world, you will fall behind. And lots of countries are doing lots of things, so it's a competitive marketplace. What I want to do today, and I think I have about 20 minutes, is to kind of take the debate up to about 80,000 feet, just to look at how important this stuff's becoming around the world. And then I'm going to duck down and look at a few very specifics about how a number of countries, not just Ireland, have used their diaspora to create jobs, to get investment, and to build their economies. I put together a few slides here. I hope that this machine works. Okay, sorry about that. Sort of don't interfere with your sets. Slight interlude there. Hopefully we'll get this right. So what I want to do is kind of go up to 80,000 feet and sort of talk about diaspora. And the origins of diaspora actually go right back to the 5th century BC, the exile of the Jews from Babylon. It's always been associated with the Jews and with Israel. But what's interesting is that now this thing has become more mainstream. And Tim mentioned this morning The Economist. So The Economist put diaspora on its cover, the magic of diaspora, how migrant business networks are changing the world. And that suddenly broke through a little bit. Now diaspora is becoming kind of a mainstream issue. I always felt that up till then, most people thought diaspora was something you took two of with a headache. They didn't really understand the word. It's actually two Greek words, dia meaning over, and spiro meaning scattering. So The Economist helped bring things up to another level. And then Anne-Marie Slaughter, who works for the State Department in the United States, a fascinating woman. She's a Princeton professor. And she wrote some interesting stuff. She said, the information age is over. We now live in the networked age. And in the networked age, the measurement of power is connectedness. Now it's about being engaged. The world is no longer about countries. It's about connected clusters of creative people. And she said, now where you're from means where you can and do go back. She said the 20th century was a billiard ball world, countries colliding off each other in economic and military conflict. And now we are all interconnected. And we're all involved with each other in so many different ways. Joseph Nye, professor in Harvard, he came up with this concept called soft power. Hard power is economic and military might. Soft power is your diaspora, and that's what Kenya has, incredible soft power. Soft power is the ability to get what you want through attraction rather than coercion. Diaspora is a fantastic example of that. Now, we live in a fundamentally and utterly and brutally kind of changed world. The world is more changed than it's ever been before. It's also more interconnected and interdependent than ever before. So the opportunities are global, but the challenges are global. Whether they're climate change, whether they're exploding populations, youth unemployment, terrorism, these are all global issues that we have to find ways to tackle. And the key, what we have to do in implementing all of this, is to be able to handle change. And handling change is tough. It was Peter Drucker, the American management consultant, who said, to create the future, you have to be the enemy of today. And it was Charles Darwin, the British anthropologist, who said, it's not the strongest of the species that survives, it's not even the most intelligent that survives, but those most able to handle change. And diasporas are ideally suited to handle change in the world. So why does this stuff matter? Why do diaspora matter? Well, firstly, there's been massive growth in countries engaging with their diasporas. The Migration Policy Institute in Washington said that there's been 450 initiatives in over 55 countries, a third of them started in the last 5 years. But what's made it happen is technology and communications are changing everything. People are connecting instantaneously, constantly, intensely. When I was a kid, a youngster out of college, I emigrated to the United Kingdom. I rang my parents once a year, and I reversed the charges. But these days, people are speaking every day by Skype to their children. And what's different is that now, in the old days, Absence equaled exile. Exile equaled absence. Now you can be here and there. You can lead hyphenated lives. You can be Australian and Greek, Canadian and Polish, American and Kenyan. Your geography in the old days dictated your identity. You lived in Southern California, that's what you are. But now actually you can have a foot in both camps. We say geography is history. And we lead these transnational lives. So what were once lost actors, people who've left us, sometimes our best and brightest have left us, actually are now national assets. And bizarrely, those countries who lost the most to emigration are in the best position today to benefit from these people. Diaspora matters because migration today is a toxic topic globally. No politician will touch it. It's bad news all the time. But diaspora is good news. Diaspora is positive. But diaspora is only an outcome from migration. Your diasporas are highly motivated. They have knowledge, they have expertise, they have contacts, they have resources. And economic models have now changed. The old economic model was everything happened in the core country, and then it was low-scale manufacturing in periphery countries. That's changed. Look at this. I've got this product with me today. It's an Apple iPhone. This is an American company. This product is made in Shenzhen in China. There's 651 components in this product, not a single component made in the United States. But $321 of every phone goes to an American company, Apple. So when I was growing up, the factors of production were raw material, labor, and capital, and now they're ingenuity, creativity, invention, and that is location agnostic. It's important, diasporas, because quite frankly, life is a game of inches. The difference between success and failure is tiny. You win a race by a second. You win a golf after 4 days by one stroke. The difference between success and failure is so close, and diasporas can play a huge role because, particularly with inward investment, when deals are like 50-50, diasporas can be the nudge factor. Diasporas can be the thing that tips a deal over in your direction, in your favor. And so there is such a thing as diaspora direct investment, DDI, as a subset of FDI. And that's fascinating because you have people in positions of influence around the world, positions in companies, and you can use these people to be that nudge factor. Because when you win an FDI decision, you win everything. When you come second, you get nothing. And what we're seeing now is what I call business rock stars emerging, particularly in the United States. So you look at somebody like Indra Nooyi, CEO of Pepsi, 54 years of age, born and educated in India, but went to university in the United States to do her PhD, joined Boston Consulting Group, joined a client, Pepsi, rose up to be CEO of Pepsi, 350,000 employees. But that's not what's interesting. What's interesting is Indra Nooyi is head of the US-India Business Council. Mukhtar Kent is the head of Coca-Cola. He's head of the US-Turkey Business Council. Andrew Liveris is the head of Dow Chemicals. He's head of the US-Greek Business Council. Craig Barrett, former CEO and chairman of Intel, is head of the Irish Technology Leadership Group. So this is interesting. This is different. This is new. If these people had done that 25 years ago, they would be regarded as being disloyal to the United States, and now there's a recognition. This is important. This is important as America develops its business interests globally. And also, it's important, diaspora, because there's a difference between the nation and the state. The state lines on a map. The state just is a geographical entity. A nation is actually a global notion. And certainly, as Tim was saying this morning, we have this notion that the Irish is actually an empire not built by military might or physical force, but the fact that so many people emigrated, 10 million emigrated from Ireland, and positioned themselves all around the world, that now we're able to connect back with these people. And some of these people are getting into positions of influence, just like there are Kenyans in positions of influence. And I tell you what, over the next 25 years, tens and tens of thousands of Kenyans will die around the world who are in your diaspora, who are extremely influential people and will probably not consider Kenya in their will. But we are on the cusp of the greatest intergenerational transfer of wealth in the history of mankind. And you saw 2 weeks ago when a young kid of 31 years of age gave away $44 billion, Zuckerberg Initiative. And we're seeing that more and more. So there is a hierarchy of involvement, which is why the philanthropy, why the remittances is so important. Remittances, $560 billion in the year 2013. And that doesn't include what doesn't go through the banking system. It's now three times official development assistance. In the old days, It was the reverse. So remittances are the start, and then you get into philanthropy, then you get into business development, then you get into institutional change, getting people involved through the portal of philanthropy, through the portal of remittances, then opens up opportunities of doing other things in other directions. So, can't see my slides. So, here you have just some statistics, extraordinary statistics on this, the sheer numbers of people. Actually, it's gone up. There's actually more people now. It's 250 million people now live outside the country they were born in. You have London being the fourth largest French city in the world. So what we're seeing is extraordinary global mobility around the world. I can't even see these slides. I'm not sure how I can see the slides. I can't see what's on the slides. Sorry, I can't see the slides, unfortunately, so I'm not sure what I'm talking to. Actually, do me a favor. Let me just turn it off, please. Do you mind? Okay. Don't worry. I'm just gonna talk away from the notes. We don't need to do that. So that's why I'm saying why diaspora matters. But you know, when you ask yourself four really big questions, and these big questions are: what made China the world's great manufacturing power? What made Israel the startup country of the world for technology? What made India this extraordinary global technology hub? And in our case, what helped resolve the crisis and the difficulties and problems we had in Northern Ireland? The answer to each one is the same. It's always the same. It's networking their diasporas. And here's what's interesting. The word diasporas is really interesting, but I think it's the verb in that sentence which actually is more interesting. It's that verb, networking. And if you look at these different countries, it's actually the networking that got them to where they are. And if you look at a country like China, where 80% of FDI in China is actually from the Chinese diaspora, where the Chinese is not the emergence of China, it's the re-emergence of China, where Guangzhou is this whole concept, is about networking. If you look at India in the year 2002, and India is a great example for Kenya, in the year 2002, India had no relationship with its diaspora. In fact, there was a relationship. India hated their diaspora hated India. There was 27 million people in the Indian diaspora. Their wealth equals 2/3 of the GDP of India. They're the highest paid ethnic group in the United States. And in the year 2002, Manmohan Singh, who was the Foreign Minister for Foreign Affairs, instituted a high-level commission. They spent 18 months talking to the Indian diaspora and key listening to the Indian diaspora. And what they found was the Indian diaspora said, "You're corrupt and you're excessively bureaucratic." And India went back and brought about a series of changes. And they introduced a Ministry of Overseas Indian Affairs, MOIA, the OIFC, the Overseas Indian Facilitation Center, which facilitated inward investment in India. They held an annual conference in January where 3,000 Indian CEOs around the world came back to India. They introduced a new passport called the OCI, the Overseas Citizen of India. So they did a whole load of things. So suddenly they created through that process a notion of global Indianness that never existed before. And if you watch Prime Minister Modi now, everywhere he goes, it's about the Indian diaspora. He's mobbed like a rock star wherever he goes. I mentioned Israel, who've always been great in this space for obvious reasons. And yet they've used their diaspora to drive their industry. In 1990, in Israel was an agricultural country, and now it's a high-tech hub. No Israeli companies on NASDAQ in 1990, 127 today. And they used their diaspora. They used their diaspora for their bonds, and bonds was mentioned earlier. Israeli bonds have contributed over $35 billion to the Israeli economy. They've had venture capital funds. They've all sorts of interesting initiatives there. And then you look at that Ireland, the country that I was just mentioning earlier, and Tim talked about it. We have a really interesting model on our engagement. Our engagement is a public-private engagement. Lots of interesting governmental initiatives, but also a lot of private initiatives. And the concept is let 1,000 flowers bloom. Some will succeed, some won't succeed. And that's been extremely successful.
So in my presence in this meeting is to petition and appeal to the diaspora members to come up with a system where we can get appropriate financing system among the Jwakalis and of course technology, which is one thing, so that we can be able to identify what markets are available for their products. Today in this country, everybody who has gone to school has gone to school with a Jua Kali box. But it has remained the same all the years since we finished school to date. Now, there's nobody worried. The economy, these people are contributing 25% of the GDP. These people are 9 million plus. They have extension families. So we are talking about 18 million people. Then when you talk about teachers, only 13,000 teachers. So what we are talking about here, and is just appeal to the diaspora members. Like in Ireland, I would want to know in Ireland, what is the capacity of the diaspora members in Ireland? How many are they? What are they doing? What is the available market for our commodities from Kenya into the markets? Then those members there who are willing to partner with the local sector, we put a kitty so that as we remit, as Cisse was saying, this remittance should have a focus, not just to come in the country to be eaten by our relatives. We must have a focus. The Council of Governors has indicated as a resolution to give 50 acres of land for industrial parks in every county. That's where I'm focusing. Can the diaspora members come up with a solution where we can say, can we develop those industrial parks in every county to be able to focus on some products into external markets? Thank you very much.
Yeah, great question. And you brought up a lot of points that I don't feel would be, having arrived yesterday, I would have the authority to be telling Kenya what to do and where to do it in this particular space, except to say the IDA, the Inward Investment Agency, I worked for 8 years for them, who set up in Ireland to bring in overseas investment. We decided that we wanted multinational companies in Ireland. We said that there's only one thing worse than being exploited by a multinational company, and that's being ignored by a multinational company. And so we had a program and a policy to bring these people in, and they came in at a low level of production, very simple stuff, assembly, you know, putting computers together, very simple stuff. And the longer they stayed, the more sophisticated the operations became. And so what we did at a country level was to create the enabling conditions to allow these companies to be welcomed into Ireland. And this just success spread. We moved up the food chain. It's now very sophisticated, the operations that are going on. So, you know, my thoughts would be really creating enabling conditions here, using your diaspora to open doors internationally. I was at the launch of SACO in Ireland some time ago. I think you have an engaged diaspora there will help Kenya export its products into Ireland. So it is about coming up with a variety of projects, a variety of policies that suit all those different niches that exist within your diaspora.
Thank you very much. I'm not going to take another question or comment, Dr. Shem Ochiodho. I think I'm going to leave it. Shem, I think we'll take it later because you're running short of time. Sorry for that. I'm just going to go to the next presenter, Mr. Paul Nzalu. From Mr. Peter Nzalu, sorry for that, who is from the Central Bank of Kenya. Welcome.
This year, the remittances are going to surpass the 1.5 billion mark. As of October, we had remittances up to around 1.3 billion. And when you look at the phenomenal growth, it's around 422 growth since when the records were started by Central Bank 2004 to last year. As a central bank, why should we be involved in diaspora remittances, other for the measurement? We realized that in the last few years, from 2008, when there was a financial slowdown in the whole world, which started with the subprime crisis in the US, there was a lot of volatility in the foreign exchange markets. And just to mention how we determine our currency rates in this country, we have adopted the free floating exchange rate, whereby we allow the forces of supply and demand of Forex to determine the level of equilibrium for the currency. Of course, we have concerns we would not allow the currency to be very volatile. So as a central bank, sometimes we are forced to intervene to make sure that we stem the volatility. But having said that, this year, up to November 11th, we looked at how the currencies are performed. and we took a basket of 20 currencies, and we realized that the Kenya shilling, despite the concerns which have been raised by many people, that the shilling has depreciated, was rating around the 20th, with losing around 12.9%. Worth noting is that there are some currencies like the Zambian kwacha, which lost under the period of review 92.5%. And previously in the month, the currency had actually lost more than 100%. So this reinforces the position that as the monetary authority, central bank has been keen to ensure that we safeguard the value of your money and specifically the Kenya shilling. One of the issues which came out is that despite having our slump in our traditional sources of forex earners, such as tea, coffee, horticulture, and tourism, the resilience of diaspora remittance was very critical in trying to support the supply side of the forex. And of course, this contributed to the stability we have witnessed in the Kenya shilling. Now, let us move to looking at the costs of remittances. Basically, we collect data to show how remittances flow into the country. And we, from the start, we started looking at three blocks. That is North America, Europe, and the rest of the world. And we also collect data to compare the costs. Of course, with the introduction of African Institute of Remittances, who is representative, the director here, we'll be working towards to see how we can quantify the cost of remittances, especially within the country. But what I wanted to mention is that for remitting of diaspora remittance, remittances from diaspora, we have a lot of intermediaries whereby you do have on one side, you have the remitter agent. I think you can see, you can try to see whether you can see from the projection there. Then we have remitting service provider, we have the remitting service provider bank, we have the remitting national payment system, and then the central banks. So in all these, there's a lot of intermediation, and of course this brings around about the loading of costs. So central bank, we have been keen enough to come up with innovations to see how we can take care of this. And I'm going to mention that on the measures we have taken to reduce the cost of remitting remittances from the diaspora. One, as a central bank, we have tried to encourage competition. You realize that the traditional sources of conduits for remitting money have been Western Union and MoneyGram. But in Kenya, we realize that there are so many informal remittances corridors, such as the hawalas. And of course, some of them are skewed towards the Somali community because of the issues we have with the Horn of Africa security and the war. So we looked at all these, and locally we licensed 16 remittance operators, which are now competing with the traditional MoneyGram and the Western Union. And also, we have also tried to integrate the payment systems. We have kept the Kenya Electronic Payment Settlement System, which now we want to integrate with the other national payment systems within the region, that is Uganda and Tanzania. And worth noting is the phenomenal mobile money transfer, M-Pesa. We also have now Airtel Money, Equitel, in the same ranks. And we have also been able to allow innovation in the banking sector, whereby now these mobile money transfers are integrated with the payment systems and also the banks, to the extent that you can actually access your funds, or you can transfer your funds from your bank account into your mobile phone. Commercial banks have also been keen to embrace the uptake of internet banking, And you have seen that most of the banks here, and some of you are from the diaspora, you could actually be able to access your local account here through an internet platform, of course, which is secured by the respective banks. And also importantly, we have also looked at the facet of financial inclusion, and we brought on board microfinance deposit taking institutions, and we have grown with them over time actually to recognize them as microfinance banks and also include them in the clearinghouse. So this is to try to reach out on the unbanked population within the country to spread the financial services to the unbanked. Also, banks traditionally specialize on interbank market, and they do volumes. So we recognize that there's need for including the needs of the retailers. That is those people who have $200 bill, $500 bill, or even 20. So we licensed 83 Forex bureaus around the country, whereby all these individuals who have been sent or who have loan denominated dollar bills or even other foreign currency can exchange in these Forex bureaus at a competitive rate. So what have we seen as barriers to increased diaspora remittances? The first one is the investment climate. We have seen that the investment climate has been somewhat restrictive because of the, I would say, the outlook in exchange rate, interest rates, volatility, both in the domestic market and also some concerns about political climate in the country. So the people here will get first-hand information about the affairs in the country, but sometimes what goes out through the international press might not necessarily be what is on the ground, and this somehow tends to restrict the investment climate. I've also mentioned the cost of remittance, but also the size of migration. Migrants has been relatively low in Kenya compared to the other regions, and the use of mobile technologies is only limited to this country. I mean, if you want to transfer money across the border, sometimes we may have limitations. The only good thing worth mentioning is that we have actually allowed Safaricom to engage in remittances business, which was previously not the case. There are also issues of the money laundering concerns, but in this country, I'm happy to report that the national ID has been recognized as one of the documents which can be used to identify recipients of funds comfortably. So why would we look at Kenya as a preferred destination for investment, especially from the diaspora? From our perspective, we have developed and made the financial market fairly deep and developed compared to the other countries within the region. So that one gives a comfort of the stability within the region. And again, we have developed secondary markets for financial products such as treasury securities and corporate bonds, which are liquid, and also fairly for treasury securities, less risky. We have an average of daily turnover of around 5.5 billion for the treasury securities and corporate bonds, which is fairly a huge turnover, and the amounts are in Kenya shillings. We have also made the market infrastructure efficient and effective. And of course, this entails also the automation of the payment systems. Previously, it used to take a longer period to clear checks, and we have also looked at the amounts to the extent that instead of taking 5 days, now within 2 or so days at most, you can be able to get the value of your money, and also capping the large amounts of 1 million to go through the electronic funds transfer just to curb on fraudsters. Okay, so opportunities which probably the bank are seen as viable. And worth noting is that the central bank has been keen to provide an enabling environment whereby all the players, in terms of coming with products and the research which could be geared towards improving the utility of remittances from the diaspora. So from global perspective, we see that remittances will remain a key source of funds in developing countries, both for the capital flows and also supporting consumer and investment avenues for the retailers. And we have seen that the World Bank Global Economic Perspective, which was released in 2015, has observed that diaspora remittances remain less volatile than any other source of capital flows. For developing countries, there is a projection of 0.9% growth in 2015, which is about a fifth of the average rate growth from the previous 3 years. And we also see that officially from the same report that remittances have reached $436 billion in 2014, which is an increase of 4.4% from a year ago. And this projection is expected to grow through, could rise to 586 in 2015, 636, all through to 2017. So ladies and gentlemen, that is my presentation. And I would also like to extend a goodwill message and Christmas greetings from our governor, Dr. Patrick Njoroge, and all the CBK staff. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Nzalu. That is another very good good presentation, self-explanatory. I don't think the diaspora has any questions, I believe. And I therefore would like to move forward because of time. We have had two presenters talking from Kenya, but from outside an outside perspective. We have two presenters from the government, and we're going to have two presenters from the diaspora. So I'm now going to call upon the next presenter, the Chief Executive Officer of IEBC, Mr. Ezra Chiloba, to come and talk about diaspora voting, because most of the issues that we're talking about here today is all about our democratic right of electing national and county governments. Mr. Chiloba, please.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, of course, our brothers and sisters from Fund Wide, welcome back home. I'm just here to make a presentation on matters voting, as that is our mandate as a Independent Electoral Boundaries Commission, and I'll try to make it quick. In fact, a few slides that we have, I'll have to skip them so that we get into the main subject on how the Commission is preparing to facilitate the participation of the diaspora, or Kenyan diaspora, in the coming elections. That is the 2017 general elections. Ladies and gentlemen, allow me to start by saying that managing elections, especially in a country like Kenya, it's not an easy thing. It's a complex affair. And we always say that other than war, the next big thing in terms of complexity is elections. Yeah, other than war. So you can imagine deploying a military or contingent of about 300,000 people on on the day you are attacking your enemy. That's what happens during the election day. We have to deploy about 300,000 officers out there to go and facilitate voting. And these complexities, often we talk about them in terms of, you can get the slides going, in terms of, you know, the perspective of the voter. When you plan to run an election, how do you plan from the perspective of the voter? Often we look at the voter as a person, as a customer, who wants to get to the polling station, and when they get there, they want to spend as little time as much as possible so that they vote, and to ensure that, of course, whatever comes out of that exercise is something they can say, yes, this represents my will. But there's also the complexity from the side of the election administrator, which is me. For us to be able to pick certain strategies during election, we must look at the different competing interests. You look at the constraints of time, you look at the institutional constraints that is in terms of the legislation, to see to it that whatever you're doing meets the minimum threshold of delivering free, fair, and credible elections. Ladies and gentlemen, of course, if you get in the details of that in terms of complexities, we're talking about human resources and office administration, we're talking about logistics, financial controls, and the financial controls, we're talking about a budget of 30 billion Kenyan shillings being used in running elections, especially under the new constitutional dispensation. We are talking about dealing with different stakeholders, among whom, of course, we are likely to see disputes. In the last general election, of course, we had about 200 election petitions. And to just deal with that is a humongous task. And so when we set out our operations, we appreciate the fact that there's so many things that have to be done before you deliver an effective, efficient, and credible election. And most of these activities have to be carried out simultaneously. At the same time, some have to be carried out sequentially, in the sense that some activities cannot happen unless preceded by other activities. And in the event that we fail to appreciate that fact, we're likely to have what we call the domino effect. One brick in the setup leads to the collapse of the entire system of electoral management. And I'm sharing this perspective so that you appreciate the things we have to deal with when it comes to organizing diaspora participation or diaspora elections. So in the current period, I just wanted to share with you that the Commission is in a new strategic phase. After the 2013 elections, what happened is that we reviewed what had transpired at the time, and one of the lessons learned is that better planning is likely to lead to better results in terms of electoral outcomes, not in terms of the person we are voting for, but the entire system in terms of efficiency, effectiveness, and credibility. So we had to change our new strategic plan. We started a new strategic phase starting in June this year. And our strategic plan is actually structured within what we call the electoral cycle. We're not looking at elections as an event, but we're looking at elections as a process that starts immediately after one election has ended. And within the perspective of the electoral cycle, of course, there are many things that we have to ensure that happen. One of the things we're paying attention to is the legal reform, legal framework. We identified some gaps in the last general election, and as far as the legal framework is concerned. And so far, we've made proposals to change some of the provisions of the law so that we infuse a bit more of efficiencies, especially when it comes to timelines during voter registration, timelines in dispute resolution, timelines in terms of dealing with party nominations, among others. And at the same time, we just started the process of planning and implementation in terms of setting out the milestone, the critical milestones in terms of what we have to achieve from now all the way to the 2017 general election. And one of the major issues, of course, we're looking at is voter registration, revamping our technology, as well as enhancing the participation of the diaspora in the elections. So we have developed what we're calling the 2017 elections roadmap. In other places, we call it the elections operations plan, which basically sets out those priorities to ensure that the priorities that we have identified under our new strategic plan are well implemented in accordance with the provisions of the Constitution and based on the lessons learned in the last general election. I think you have to go faster. I'm faster than when. Yes. I think go to the fifth slide from where you are. And in that respect, ladies and gentlemen, our elections operations plan basically identifies some of the critical issues that we have to pay attention to going forward. And those issues are around operational and logistics requirements, legal reforms and electoral technology, economic aspects that affect elections, matters security, as well as social, political, and cultural factors. And if you look at our priority listing, we have what we have identified a number of areas, which are about 15 areas that we are paying attention to: legal framework, voter registration, voter education, nomination, voting, resource management, stakeholder engagement, boundary delimitation, risk management, funding, performance, and monitoring and evaluation. Ladies and gentlemen, in doing so, we have highlighted a number of principles that we pay attention to that touch on issues to do with equity, transparency, among others. Now, more particularly when it comes to diaspora registration and voting, according to what we've been able to gather now is that there's an approximate 3 million Kenyan citizens living outside there. And the Constitution, of course, recognizes their right to participate in the electoral process. So these 3 million Kenyans, of course, is just an estimate that we have, but we actually do not have the actual number when it comes to voting. And in matters of voting, you must know exactly what are the numbers that you have out there, because winning is winning about, you know, is about numbers. And of course, what we are carrying out today, ladies and gentlemen, we are doing it in light of the Supreme Court decision that, of course, as the Constitution requires us to facilitate the progressive registration of the Kenyan diaspora to exercise their right to vote, and the emphasis here is progressive. And the Supreme Court, of course, has issued its verdict on this matter, and we are trying our level best to ensure that we are also compliant. So what are some of the critical policy issues that we are paying attention to? November, I think on November 20th, the Commission adopted a policy framework to guide its work in as far as facilitating the diaspora participation in the election is concerned. And I want to invite you to look at the policy document. It is in draft form. We're going to adopt it this coming January. If you have any comments, of course, we welcome those comments. And what are some of the issues that the policy wants to address? One is that we are looking at data on Kenyan diaspora. What we've established is that we do not have reliable data on how many Kenyans are out there. We are looking at how time zone differences affect administration of elections. For example, the law says that results must be announced within 7 days after voting. How does that therefore, when you talk about announcing results at say 10 o'clock in Kenya, what will that mean for Australia? And even the time of voting itself, because of the different time zones, the policy also looks into that. We also appreciate that there's no consistent policies and standards to guide host governments when it comes to diaspora voting. The cost of elections, what studies have shown is that out-of-country voting will cost on average about 5 to 10 times more than the in-country voting. Then the challenge of diaspora population being scattered all over the countries. For example, today we'll say there are about 200,000 Kenyans living in the United States, but where specifically in the United States? How will that affect the way we deploy electoral services? Then out-of-country voting is much more susceptible to perceptions of fraud. This is the experience that we've had in the last 3 years. Whenever we discuss, we have conversations with the political class over these issues, there's a time we've been told blatantly that, look, you guys are planning to rig elections. Who are those people you're talking about out there? So these are matters that we have to pay attention to when we're dealing with that. Then the current law, as it's structured, requires personal voting. And personal voting means you have to appear in person to be able to cast your ballot. So in terms of the policy itself, one of the things we are saying in terms of the key principles of voting, of this policy, is that we want as much as possible to be compliant with the Kenyan legal framework. And in addition, we recognize the authority of the Commission to promulgate rules and regulations that govern diaspora participation in the election. Then we also pay close attention to the Government of Kenya policy on diaspora, as well as ensuring that we also are compliant and not in contravention with host country laws and regulations. And of course, realizing that it's only the Electoral Commission of Kenya that has got the mandate to facilitate any election. And this includes the election organized for the diaspora population. Now, what are some of the key highlights of the policy as I push towards the end? One is that I'm calling them key policy interventions. What is the Commission planning to do as you prepare for the next election? The baseline data. The Commission is planning to establish a reliable database for the diaspora population so that we know where the Kenyan diaspora are located, how many they are, what is their status, and how best can we provide electoral services to them. On questions of eligibility, of course, we are focusing on Kenyans who are 18 years and above and hold a valid Kenyan passport. In terms of setting up registration centers, we are saying that we'll be looking at countries where Kenya has diplomatic presence, and more particularly on issue, and when it comes to population, we are saying we must have at least 3,000 eligible Kenyans registered with the Foreign Affairs, or Ministry of Foreign Affairs or our embassies, so that we use that as a threshold for purposes of setting up registration centers. 3,000 eligible Kenyans registered with our missions abroad. In terms of participation, the type of elections that you're supposed to participate in, the policy talks about presidential elections and the referenda. In terms of voting, as we've said, it will be voting in person as prescribed by the Kenyan law. In terms of the voting period, we'll also comply with the Kenyan timelines, and there'll be no voting allowed outside the time already set by the Kenyan by the Kenyan law. Then we are suggesting or saying that agents and election observers are free to observe elections in foreign countries as long as they're able to meet the cost of that observation. In terms of elections offices, we're giving the commission the mandate to, or the freedom to the discretion rather, to be able to recruit Kenyans living abroad and designate them or gazette them as election officials. We look forward to partnering and collaborating with other actors to enhance a voter education program that is specific for the diaspora population. The policy also looks at collaboration in terms of working closely with the state and non-state actors. And when we're talking about state actors, I think the Ministry of Foreign Affairs becomes very critical. Non-state actors, your groups, organizations that coordinate your activities abroad, I think are going to play a critical role when it comes to this type of collaboration. In terms of host country issues, we expect that the Minister of Foreign Affairs will work closely with the Commission to negotiate on any agreements that will facilitate us to carry out our mandate in those respective countries. Lastly, ladies and gentlemen, the policy is structured in such a way that we want to learn from each and every exercise that we carry out. And we're going to develop a robust implementation framework in this regard, which will be shared by yourselves. And most importantly, we have a constant monitoring and evaluation of this particular policy in line with the decision of the Supreme Court, which requires us to file every year an annual report on how what is it that the Commission is doing to ensure that the right to vote by the Kenyan diaspora is progressively realized. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to invite us that as we approach the next election, if you really want to participate in this exercise, support us to support you. Support us in providing us with information that will facilitate your participation in the election. This year, in February, we put up a small portal where we were looking for information from yourselves in terms of where you are, your contact details, to help us at least have an idea on the spread of the Kenyan diaspora population abroad. But the feedback has not been very encouraging. By October, we had about 1,500 people who had logged on onto the website. That was the data. And we liaised with the Minister of Foreign Affairs on the same, who also have the same platform, a similar platform, and also the fact that they register the Kenyan diaspora in respective embassies in respective countries, and the data that they've shared with us is also not very encouraging. While the projections, in fact, according to Washington, your projections are telling me now they're 800,000. Are you suggesting we revise our 3 million? And out of that 800,000, that is from the number of countries. I think there are about 40 countries that they've worked on, not all the countries around the world. And from that, only about 100,000 are registered with the respective missions. Is that data reliable enough for us to be able to make that decision? So I think we need to work together to ensure that we have an easy time to provide electoral services when it comes to 2017. What we are going to do in January this year, ladies and gentlemen, is to share with the country the elections roadmap. And in that elections roadmap, you will see what is it specifically, when is it in terms of the actual date that the Commission is going to visit some of your host countries to have a conversation with yourselves, and also to provide registration services, at least as a precursor of the next general election. The presentation is a bit detailed, and I'm going to leave it with our colleagues here to share with yourselves But in summary, I think that's what I can say the commission is doing to prepare for the 2017 elections in as far as diaspora registration and voting is concerned. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chiloba, for that presentation. I know most of us have been awaiting for you to come in and say something about our voting, the next general elections. And I believe at this juncture that most of us, or some of us, have questions that they want to raise with you. I'm just going to open the floor to take three burning questions that will be addressed to the CEO of IEBC, because he has to rush to another engagement immediately after this. Three questions. We have four of them.
Hello.
Make it short, please.
Yes. My name is Mary Liz. I'm a student here in Kenya, and I wanted to ask the IEBC officer if maybe, I'm not really tech savvy or something, but I'm thinking, because these people are in the diaspora, and also considering the fact that given the security issues that have been around Africa through a period of time, it's definitely going to be hard to lobby for them to allow people to have polling stations in their countries. But have they thought in the direction where, for instance, they come up with a portal where every Kenyan who is in the diaspora, the government working together with IEBC, identify the people and have a portal that updates everyone who is in the diaspora and the information updated, so that when it's time for voting, they have a link that they create for these people who are in the diaspora, the time that they've been given, the day of voting, they're given a specific time where they can log in and vote as per who they want to vote for, and then the website is updated with people who have been put on the posters on the voting papers so that they can be voted for. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next question.
Thank you for the presentation. My name is David Chege. I'm from California. My question has to do with it's two things. How much diaspora engagement do you actually have as you're addressing these issues in our environment? As we've already, in our environment, some of these issues have already addressed. Specifically, like I know in California, we do mail our ballots if we want to, and there are methods for actually validating. So there's things that we can bring to the table. So that's my first question. The second one was, in order to get the diaspora engagement, my sense is there isn't a firm yes, we'll be able to vote at this particular point. And so without an assurance that there's a commitment that you will make it available, then my sense is from our communities is that, okay, what is the engagement? So I guess I'm asking, are you for certain that you will make it available on 2017? Thank you.
Thank you very much. There's another question behind there. Not there at the end, on this side. There, at the back, please.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Catherine Mwell. I'm representing a friend from America. And he has this question. Why is it not possible for a person who has got both citizenship, a Kenyan one and an American one, not eligible to vie for elective position in Kenya, and yet they are investing in our country immensely? Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm taking up to six questions. I know he wants to ask one, that lady at the back wants to ask the other one, and Ochiodo will ask the last one.
Hello, my name is Mary. I'm representing groups from London. My question was really about the trying to get people on the database. And I think it's a very challenging and really is a long-term strategy, because as diaspora groups, not only from Kenya and East Africa, but also the ones we liaise with throughout Africa, that database collection is a challenge. And my sort of suggestion would be, would the, for example, the ministry and IEB consider just starting off with what we have already and having it as a work in progress, because I don't think we will have a complete database to then, you know, start registration for people. I think it might be worth working with what we have and the estimated models of worst case scenario and best case scenario and see how we go as the journey continues.
Thank you. One more question here.
Good afternoon. My name is Maina Kanyora from UK. Mine is one, Mr. Chaloba. This promise of diaspora voting is going to become a reality? That's all.
Okay. Ochiodo?
Thank you very much, Bwana MC. Maybe I could assist Ezra answer the question of dual citizens.
Just make it short.
Yeah, it's not right. They're not allowed to run for office. They can run for office, but if they're elected, then there are certain positions they can't hold, but they can run for offices. So that's a matter that we had to take also to court, and that's what the Supreme Court did rule. But my point, if you may permit, Mr. Kingsley, you allowed me just one question. I agree with most of the things he said, except one. But one of those I agree with him on is the importance of appropriate institutional framework to manage diaspora affairs. When we suggested in this country that we have a Ministry of Diaspora Affairs, some people laughed. But there are examples of India, Georgia, Nigeria, and a host of other countries. I'm glad you reiterate the same. As I know Foreign Affairs is hosting you, please keep drumming that matter, that until we get that proper institutional framework, we may not get the most out of diaspora. A question to Ezra. My question is, and we have argued this matter in court, having gone KDA to this, initially to the High Court, then Appeal Court and Supreme Court, arguing for diaspora to vote. They contended that we can only vote for presidential elections, not the other positions. And they argued it all. And the Supreme Court and the Court of Appeal said in their wisdom, diaspora be allowed to vote for all. We cannot argue about this in this meeting. When is he having a round table meeting with diaspora leaders, representatives of diaspora groups, different groups, so that we can get this matter sorted out, so that the question Maina is asking, are you serious we're going to vote in 2017 or is it talk? That can be overcome if we have a round table. I just want to know, when is he having that round table meeting with diaspora representatives? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. The next question, at the end, the last question actually.
Thank you. Reverend Andrew Mwell, I'm here representing over 200 pastors in the U.S. diaspora, and they made sure I come here. And I want to say, just last weekend, Rwanda diaspora made a big decision in the referendum. I was in the U.S. when the Sudanese citizens voted in the diaspora. Those are, if you compare Rwanda and Southern Sudan, CEO, really is possible this voting to take place. I want just to encourage the IBC, you are independent. I want, if Southern Sudan and Rwanda did it, this diaspora, we know the numbers. You might not know, you've just come to the office, but you need to engage the leadership, and the leadership has spread all over. It can work. I want just to encourage this meeting and IBC, when you take this voting ballot, or voted to be in the embassies, Kenyans are really not very, very sure of these embassies. But Southern Sudan, they did it in primary schools, they did it in churches, and they did it in other institutions, even universities. So let's do something. Let's not give up. I know it can work, but involve the diaspora. Thank you.
Thank you very much for those questions. Now I would like to invite the CEO of IBC to respond to those questions.
So sit here?
Yeah, please.
Okay, thank you very much for those
important questions. Yeah, just quickly maybe to attempt to respond to all of them. Number one, you talked about the portal, having a portal. I think we've tried a portal. The Minister of Foreign Affairs as well has tried up setting up a portal. But I think what you meant was collecting data through that portal, then extending it to e-voting, right? So that it becomes almost automatic that when it comes to voting, that platform is used to facilitate that exercise. Again, according to what I just said in terms of the policy, we say that the current law requires that the voting must be in person. Although we also know that they say we could deploy, we have the discretion to deploy technology as long as it supports the realization of free, fair, and credible elections. At the Commission, the position we've taken is that I think at this stage, as we are starting this process, it would be too early to introduce technology, knowing that even our own experience with technology, the first hand in the last elections, was not something that anyone wants to go back to. I think there's a cautious approach this time around, but that does not mean that actually such tools may not be deployed in future. And we are open in terms of consultation, but I don't see it happening with respect to the 2017 elections because of the so many preliminary issues that have to be addressed. And although I know, Dr. you launched the iVote last week, we need to talk about that as well. So we see what is possible. In terms of how much diaspora engagement we have, I think the Commission is tried. And some of you here have kept on inviting us to different parts of the world for us to participate and talk about the same subject. This year alone, I've had 3 meetings in country here and talking about the same issue. And the presentation is almost the same. So, and my colleagues have been out of the country talking about these issues. I think the last one was in Atlanta, New Jersey, in the US, and of course there was one in London. Where my chairman was talking, by that time he was making the presentation, we did not have this policy framework. Now we have the policy framework and we've made it available on the website for people to look at. And if you think the critical issues that we need to pay attention to, I think we invite, not I think, but we invite those comments so that we can push towards the realization of this right. Yes, stakeholder engagement is important. And what the policy also recognizes is that we must learn to collaborate with other actors, both state and non-state actors. And since, you know, we don't live abroad, the Commission is based here, there's no way that they're going to have a successful delivery of its mandate in terms of voting abroad unless they work with yourselves. So maybe what we could call for is better coordination when it comes to these issues. And my colleague here, of course, Washington, we've had that conversation and we want to see how best then to make this engagement robust. This year, to also come to your question, this year, sometimes in April, we are planning to have a national conference on elections. And one of the main areas and the critical participants we are inviting are going to be the diaspora population. So we need to have this conversation and appreciate what is it that the Commission has done and what is possible to be in terms of all over the world.